Well, thank you for the very generous introduction, and it's a real pleasure to be here. Thank you so much for having me here today. So the topic I'd like to talk about is sound change and analogy and paradigms, and in particular, to take a minute and try and, if I can, look ahead to why I think automated inference is on the horizon, which is different to being in the hand, but on the horizon. So I'm going to start with the success story of the comparative method and some of the reasons why we'd like to enjoy that success more widely and faster. I'll ask then, are there any quick fixes? Are there any easy options that wouldn't require too much work in order to get this thing automated and have computers do it for us? After having considered those, I'll then turn to the actually quite challenging notion of automating the comparative method itself, including along the way an example of inferring analogy in paradigms. And as it becomes clear that doing this will indeed require a lot of work, we're not deluded, it's hard, I'll finish up by asking what are the first steps perhaps, and then I'll offer some conclusions. So we start with the success story of the comparative method. And pardon me, I'll be telling you stuff that you know quite well, but let's get off to a good start. The comparative method is, of course, one of the great scientific success stories of the past two centuries. It really is wonderful. It has been, and it still is, our foremost means for discovering changes in the history of languages. It enables linguists to discover and make sense of things like sound changes, like Grimm's Law, morphological changes, as when English past tense digged became dug, we can actually say something about that, or clone became climbed. And by inferring changes like these, historical linguists reveal how languages differ from their ancestors, and in turn allows us to piece them together into linguistic family trees, or networks of historical relationships. Now, naturally, the results of this are of great interest to linguists, but it's not only linguists who find this knowledge very interesting and very useful. Other disciplines are also very interested in our results. Because languages are spoken by particular communities at particular points in time, knowledge of language histories offers a really unique insight into the historical networks of human communities, meaning that language histories have a scientific value that goes well beyond linguistics. When we have success with the comparative method, other disciplines notice and they benefit. So it's a really good thing. So the comparative method involves a number of processes, and I will characterize it in a certain way. So we start, of course, with observation. These are observations of linguistic structures across languages, and we start with a hypothesis that maybe these are historically related in a demonstrable way. And then we engage in a very sophisticated process of inference, which brings us eventually to genealogies, inferred ancestral structures or protoforms, inferences about the relationships among our original observed structures, such as cognacy, or borrowing, so forth. Now, along the way, there are many individual processes of inference that we apply. Here I'm going to simplify this so that I don't take until next week, of course, but I'll arrange them into three major steps that I would say that we perform in order each time to progress from one kind of knowledge to the next on our way through this guiding diagram, which you'll see a few times. So the first step is one which we might call, I will choose to call, alignment. Now this is a task that involves making decisions, hypotheses about which linguistic structures to compare with which. Now often we even forget that we do this, but this is a decision that we make along the way. Now it could be which segments to compare with which, it could be which words, which meanings, which inflections, they all require alignment. Now, alignment can range from the exceedingly intuitive, such as if I asked you to align these segments, this is something you would give to students in the first week of a historical linguistics course, perhaps, to the much, much more complicated things. So it took people a while to work out whether they wanted to align those two words, for example. Now, in all cases, though, the result of this step is to move from our original observed linguistic structures to something more interesting. This is inferred cross-linguistic correspondences between structures. Going on to step two is the application of diachronic typology. Four little words which contain rather a lot of interesting stuff. Now, this is really the intellectual heavy lifting. It's relying on all of what we know about what is more or less likely to occur during language change. We know that it's hard. I'm going to come to the question of whether computers can do it. Probably most of us already have a fairly good idea what we think the answer is. But the result of applying diachronic typology is that we generate a whole host of hypotheses about historically more or less likely changes. Now, in practice, we may not write them all down. We may not write down the 5,000 different possible changes that our correspondences could reflect and rank their more or less likely evaluation, but we do entertain them, and what we entertain and how we evaluate it and evaluate its likelihood is all based on diachronic typology. However it is that we may theorize it in whichever decade we're working, or what we understand it to be, us versus our colleagues or whatever. Then step three is the application of basically a fundamental logic of genealogical inference. This is also known sometimes in linguistics or in other fields which do similar stuff as cladistic or phylogenetic inference. It's going from more or less likely changes to making trees or networks. Now at the core of it, given the more or less likely historical changes that we've already inferred, we can then infer which conceivable genealogies are more or less likely, whereby genealogy I mean some kind of network of historical relations, often a tree, but it doesn't have to be, between languages that we've observed and ones in the past, coupled with the changes that relate them across time. So in addition, if we then flesh out the consequences of the genealogies for individual linguistic structures, we get great things like reconstructions of ancestral forms that allows us to talk about relationships of cognacy and so forth. And all of this is a truly complicated and wonderful achievement. It's a really powerful method. But it takes decades to perform. And since the comparative method has not been fully performed on most of the world's languages, there's really a profound bottleneck in historical linguistics. So, and particularly this is the case if you grab my accent and walk away from Europe. So as a linguist working in Australia, I can tell you it is enormously frustrating that we know so little about the knowable history of these languages. We could know this if we had enough people working on it. Australia has 400 languages, 25 language families, and there is not one linguist in the entire world who works full-time applying the comparative method to any of them. So great method, but it's slow. And moreover, this isn't just an issue for linguistics. Other disciplines rely on our results. So currently there really is a waiting time of decades for the broader interdisciplinary potential of linguistics, of our discipline, for unraveling human prehistory together with other ones who are waiting to hear from us. So I think it's obvious that ideally we'd like to move faster. And so for ages, a lot of us have had questions, how could it possibly happen? So let me first dispense with what might appear some quick fixes, what might look like easy solutions that wouldn't require too much work. And I'll go through four of them. Importing methods directly from biology. I'll talk about current lexical phylolinguistics. The nice thing of computers that run sound changes forward in time. I'll talk a little bit about phonotactic phylogenetics as well. So, as it happens, biologists perform a very, very close analog of the comparative method in their own research. Now they have different terminology, but the distinctive steps and the order in which they apply and even the underlying logic really are essentially the same. Moreover, biologists have automated their version, so can't we just go to a biologist, say, give me your computer program, I'll take it back and solve linguistics? Well, no, not currently. Not for the full comparative method. And the reason, I believe, is this. So it's these steps here. Aligning structures and applying diachronic typology is not the same in biology and linguistics. You can go to biology, you will not find morphological paradigms. And that's something that we need to do alignment with, for example. Now, to be sure, these first two inferential steps have many analogues in biology, but automated methods require and rely on very fine details. And the difference in detail between linguistic alignment and diachronic typology and biological alignment and diachronic typology is sufficiently great that there just don't currently exist any biological computer programs that we can bring over to do the whole comparative method for us. So as it currently stands, this really simplistic, just go to biology, grab their computer programs and be done, is not going to be a quick fix. Now, as you'll be aware, there's a lot of activity currently inferring trees or phylogenies using lexical lists of basic vocabulary. And we take these lists, they get manually coded up for their cognacy, and these methods use, the main ones, for example, these papers here, use cognacy scores to then infer trees. The result is phylogenies with explicit branch lengths, with quantifications of uncertainty. And these kinds of trees are really very useful for interdisciplinary crossover because other disciplines use very similar kinds of trees. If we can present them with our findings in these kind of formats, it's easy to correlate them and ask about what the implications are back and forth and so forth. But this also isn't the comparative method. So here's our comparative method. Current lexical phylolinguistics doesn't really do that part of the process. It relies on someone else to perform pretty much the entire comparative method first. Then it will take the resulting cognates that you've worked out and put them back into a model of diachronic typology, which however is constrained just to a model of lexical gain and loss, which is an important thing in language change, but it's not everything. So you feedback that into that, and what you get is really nice refinements of the genealogies, but it's not the whole comparative method. Importantly, you start from cognates, so someone's got to have done a lot of work before we even get going with these. So this also is not a quick fix to the automating the entire comparative method. So in a recent paper read to the society, Patrick Sims-Williams surveys this 6 decades of work building computational tools for running forwards in time from protoforms to predicted modern forms, given some set of sound changes. Of course, a tool like that also requires someone to tell you what the protoforms are that you're going to hypothesize to start with, what the sound changes are that you would like to run forward. So they run a very helpful kind of additional process after all of this, given your ancestral structures, your genealogy, your inferred changes. They will tell you what modern observations are predicted by them, which can then, of course, be checked against your real observations, which is great for correcting your theory and so forth. Useful as these are, they, of course, also aren't going to be a quick fix for accelerating the whole comparative method. Then, over the past several years, I have made an attempt to accelerate historical inference in languages using phonotactic information, what you could call phonotactic phylogenetics. And don't worry, I'm not about to claim that I've solved it either. This research only attempts to do this part, so it doesn't even attempt to give you protoforms or cognates at the end of it. But the process tries to compare linguistic structures, and the only structures it compares is information about phonotactics found in languages. It then goes ahead and applies a fairly impoverished statistical notion of diachronic typology. It then applies genealogical logic using automated tools, and it outputs trees. And it's done automatically. So one advantage of this that appealed to me when I first considered the idea is that unlike the other quick fixes we've seen so far, this one does not require someone else to have completed the comparative method first before you get started. So it generally does lead fairly quickly to inferred trees. The disadvantage is, after a number of years, I'm unfortunately going to report, the trees aren't that good. So here are two trees for the Parmenyungan language of Parmenyungan family of Australia. They may get better, but at this point, unfortunately, this is what I've got to report. The upper tree is inferred purely from phonotactics, and the lower tree is a standard phylolinguistic tree inferred from cognate data. The lines in the middle are, if you're wondering, oh my goodness, what is this? The lines in the middle are the secret part. They are telling you where the matches and mismatches are between the two trees. So wherever you see sets of curved lines running in parallel from a set of languages in one tree to a set of languages over here, what you're seeing is subgroups that are coherent in both trees but have been put in different places in the two trees. So essentially what we're recovering here is the subgroups. The low-level subgroups are not too bad in their recovery, but the high-level structures are just not well matched. So phonotactic phylogenetics, which is still in its infancy, and I hope it gets better, does appear to have some utility. It finds some information about family trees without requiring that someone else has done all the work of the comparative method first, but it is still absolutely not a quick way to get through the comparative method. It's not a replacement for it. It's not an automation of it. So those were four quick fixes, none of which really do the job. The reason they don't do the job is not because they tried to do it and they failed. It's because they weren't actually trying to implement and automate the comparative method. So methods from biology, yes, they correspond quite well for step three, but biology has different diachronic typology. It has different alignment of structures. Then lexical phylolinguistics, step three, building trees, is done nicely, and it's done in an automated fashion, but it only uses a very limited version of step two, that is diachronic typology, and it doesn't do step one. So it starts from cognates and funnels us back in there. Tools that run forward in time, kind of an additional, very useful check at the end of the process. And phylogenetic phonotactics does a version of 1, 2, and 3, but it only does it by looking at phonotactics, which is absolutely not the data that we tend to do the comparative method with. So for these quick fixes, none of them even really attempts to do the job. Consequently, I don't think it's surprising that they don't do the job. I wouldn't criticize them for not automating the comparative method because they weren't attempting to do that. The things that they do, perhaps they do quite well. But can we imagine automating the comparative method itself? So because there already exist, in my mind, very sophisticated automated tools for inferring genealogies, I believe the real challenging part is in these first two processes, that is alignment and the application of diachronic typology. So let me address these two tasks. So particularly in the last 5 years, some real major progress has been made on getting computers to align structures, to align forms. So to single out one very important researcher here, computational linguist Johan Mattis List has developed some very useful tools to help computers to guess which resemblant forms are worthwhile to compare across languages, which segments to compare with one another, and to help humans to then improve the guesses and feedback into a very useful loop for doing alignment. Another one I'd mentioned in a really outstanding PhD thesis a year ago, Sacha Benyamina in Paris made some really significant progress in getting computers to be able to recognize the systematic similarities within the forms in morphological paradigms. So getting computers to do this stuff is important. As humans, we find alignment often just so simple that we don't even write up that we ever did it. We probably don't tell students that they need to work it out unless they hand in some really rubbish assignments, and then we're sort of puzzling where did they go wrong. They may have got the alignment wrong. But for computers, it's a really big deal, and it's hard to get it to work, and these researchers have done some really brilliant research pushing that forward. So these tools all help computers with the basic task of hypothesizing correspondences between linguistic structures across languages, and you need to have that to get going. The thorniest challenge of all, though, is this part, definitely. Getting computers to apply anything like diachronic typology in order to transform those cross-linguistic correspondences into inferred, more or less likely changes. So why is this so hard, we might ask? Why do we not already have computers that can do it? Biologists have it, why don't we? One simple answer is this one: computers don't already do it because they can't do it, or at least they couldn't until recently. So let me explain what I mean by this. In 2013, a paper appeared in PNAS, the Proceedings of the National Academy of Sciences. Now, this is not a journal that always gets a lot of attention or praise from linguists. The paper was authored by Alexander Bouchard-Gaultier and his doctoral supervisors at Berkeley, and it presented a computational method for inferring sound change. Now, as far as I can make out, linguists who did read it, for those who did, it was approximately a complete failure. First of all, it was written in the language of the authors, which was computer science and not linguistics. Second, being a PNAS paper, it was brief and really dense. I mean, it really hurts to read it. It's just so dense. Third, its model of sound change was clearly wrong. So it allowed sound changes to be conditioned by context only on the left-hand side and not on the right. All right, where am I going from here? So all of this really is a tragedy because Alex's 2010 PhD thesis is really good. It's brilliant. So in it, because he's not confined to four pages of dense text, he takes the time to explain quite lucidly why it's actually impossible for him to infer two-sided sound change, and he gives two good reasons. First of all, now if you go and look at any textbook in historical linguistics, and you didn't have someone to help tutor you through how to interpret it, you may come away thinking that the comparative method works mainly by comparing lexical lists. That's the way we present the data and the examples, that's the problem sets that we get students to solve most of the time, and computational processes have tended to assume that this is the data that you should use. But as Alex points out in his thesis, lexical lists, particularly lists only of basic vocab, contain insufficient data for a computer program to reliably infer two-sided sound change. And I'll say a bit more about this. The second reason is that even if you could write the computer program, the universe itself contains insufficient time for the computer program to run. We've got a problem with this factorial explosion in what it needs to consider. So Alex takes quite some time and care to demonstrate why this is so. He does write it in the language of computer science. It was not translated into linguistics for the rest of us. But in there, it's a very, very nice presentation of what the problems are. So let's have a look at some of the issues here, the two issues. The first is the insufficient data problem. So consider a computer that very kindly offers to take your data and infer some sound changes. And let's suppose that the world is very simple. It is so simple that there are only 20 kinds of segments. There are only 20 segment categories in existence. We'll also assume that the world is so simple that sound changes are only ever dependent on the immediately adjacent single segments like this. And this is already a devilishly hard problem for the poor computer. There are 20 possible kinds of X, 20 possible kinds of Y, and of A, and of B. So that's 160,000 possible sound changes. If there are 40 segment classes, that becomes 2.5 million possible sound changes. And that is, even for a computer, an incredibly large number of patterns to consider when your evidence is just a few hundred lexemes. And that's before we consider things like deletions and insertions, changes that involve not single segments, but classes of segments, all of which just continue to explode outwards. This can genuinely make you wonder, how do we clever humans do it? Because we overcome this problem. We overcome the problem of insufficient data. If we knew exactly how we do it, it might help us help the computers to get along easier. I will not answer this question in total. I do not know the answer, but something that we should be thinking about. One thing that we certainly do is we do have good ways of honing in on what we think is the best data, the most useful. So we seek out cases, for example, where, so we're worried about X and what happens to it. So we look at it not only between A and B, but we want, okay, now look at, keep the A there and we'll look at between A and C. We'll keep the B there and look at between D and B. Or okay, we've looked at X in that environment, let's look at other things in the same environment. So we look for a focal segment in multiple contexts, or a context containing multiple foci. A really good source of information of that kind, and this is where my morphologist comes out, is morphological paradigms. They have lots of this kind of stuff. Morphological paradigms are filled with the same item in different contexts, the same context containing different items in an almost systematic way. And in reality, humans who do the comparative method will, of course, look at morphological paradigms if there are some available in search of this kind of information that we need. The second problem was the problem of insufficient time, or we might call it the intractability problem. So as a mathematician and computer scientist writing in 2010, Bouchard Couté very capably explains how a computational model of sound change can quickly become impossible to run in a feasible amount of time, which is pretty grim news. But there is good news. So as it so happens, Bouchard Couté was as he was finishing off his thesis, there was a new generation of statistics that was just getting started, which has become a really big thing. So in recent years, so-called likelihood-free inferential methods, sounds like maths, doesn't it? Including approximate Bayesian computation, which at least has a nice acronym, ABC, has become a really big thing in statistics. And in a nutshell, it's got a new innovation, and the innovation is to use a new strategy for tackling problems which, back in 2010, were widely regarded as intractable. And the key is that rather than attempting to actually solve certain very difficult or perhaps impossible equations, the so-called likelihood equations, we go to a likelihood-free framework, and instead you run a very large number of simulations and you use them to hone in on a solution. So you may have a problem which is unsolvable, but this is a way around it, and this is the innovation. So I will attempt to give an intuitive idea of how it works. So let's say we have four languages here, and A, B, C, and D, and we've observed some number of their properties that we want to do reconstructions about, and I've put them there as colored boxes. Now we're going to use simulations to infer the histories of these four related languages. We begin with a completely random simulation. So we just randomly pick any old proto-language. Don't try and make sense at this point. A random tree, we'll put a bunch of random changes along the branches of those trees, which will produce four descendant languages. Now we're ready to start. So at each step, what we do is we generate a new simulation, which is very slightly different to the previous one. Here I just changed one of the properties in the proto-language. Now this produces a new set of descendant languages, and we then compare the two simulations to our actual observed languages over here. And we then use that information, that comparison, which one is better, as a way of rejecting one of those two simulations. So we're asking which one got closer to the actual observations. We use that, we reject one of the simulations, and then we start over. So we produce the next simulation made by a tiny difference. This time I've changed the tree a little bit. And I will do the simulation again. And we just repeat the process. So compare, reject, simulate, compare, reject, simulate. And by iterating that process millions of times over, we will slowly converge towards a simulation that produces an outcome very similar to our real-world observations. And that's how you use simulations to infer history. Now, because these new statistical methods use simulations rather than trying to solve impossible equations, they can be used on a wider range of problems. And this has got the mathematicians and statisticians very excited. They can now go back to what used to be impossible problems and start solving them. And of course, maybe that includes language. So if we're to succeed, it seems that at the moment, with technology this year, the task will be to simulate change using linguist knowledge about diachronic typology. So don't go off and just simulate nonsense. Do simulations that make sense for linguists. And in that case, let me move on to ask the question, what might it entail to work with simulations? So let me start with a point of reference. The most sophisticated science of simulation ever produced, I'm going to say, is, guess, weather forecasting. Right. Weather forecasting is a science that is funded by hundreds of millions of pounds worldwide. It has thousands of scientists working at it, and I think it's safe to say, unfortunately, we historical linguists won't have that level of resources. Nevertheless, there's a real similarity between the goals of weather forecasting and the goals of simulating language change. That is, weather forecasting entails simulating a complex system of interacting parts changing through time, which is essentially our goal with language. So what can we learn from weather forecasting? So these days, as you'll know, weather forecasts come from our phones, which connect directly to a big computer which ran a huge simulation. But even just 10 years ago, that wasn't the case. The results 10 years ago went from the big simulations and were given to expert humans called meteorologists. And they would add extra knowledge, for example, knowledge about a particular locality and the conditions there, which was not currently represented in the big simulations that ran on the computer because the simulations weren't powerful enough. And this, I think, is what we should expect it to be like working as historical linguists with simulations. The simulation should do some work quickly and powerfully, but the results will then be given over to us, the expert humans, who will add more knowledge to them. So, with this kind of thing in mind, 2 months ago, in mid-November, I gathered a group of about a dozen researchers, some of whom are here, thanks for being here, in Jena. And half of these people were linguists, specializing in morphology and phonology with a good knowledge of historical linguistics, and half were mathematicians. And for 2 days, we attempted to listen to one another and to understand how we might begin with the challenge of automating the comparative method in this kind of environment. And as we linguists listen to what the mathematicians told us that they find challenging, they emphasized the critical nature of the step where you have two simulations and we're trying to reject one of them by comparing the outcomes that they simulated with our observations. And they emphasized that that step of comparison needs to be easy. It needs to be based on something very simple, like even a single number, or perhaps a short list of numbers, so that they can easily calculate the answer to the question. Does simulation one score higher or lower than simulation two? Now, you give two different sort of scenarios to linguists and say, does this compare to this? And we can go off for 80 years arguing about, you know, how they were better or not and so forth. But mathematicians need an answer, please. This is really important for them. Without that, it's very hard for them to do their job. So on the one hand, okay, if we're going to try and do this, this requires something that linguists are very, very good at. We are very good at making abstractions over complex linguistic structures. We do that a lot. On the other hand, it'll kind of push us to make an extreme level of abstraction that we don't normally do, coming up with numerical scores about similarity. Now, to be honest, again, this is kind of repeating, I'm not here with the answers, I don't know what those scores will look like. That's something for future work to start looking at, but I think we can actually already say something about what it might mean to be forced to work with really serious abstractions. And so I'd like to take the example of what it might mean to work with really horribly severe abstractions when we're talking about analogy in paradigms. So inflectional paradigms like verb conjugations or noun declensions frequently contain more than one pattern for inflecting a given a lexeme in a language. So let's take the really simple example of English verbs. We have one pattern here, sing, sang, sung, but there are other ways that you can inflect your verbs in English. You could have cling, clung, clung, or dip, dipped, dipped. Now, I'm going to add some color here just to correspond to the way that the tense forms are built. Right, now let's go to some historical linguistics. As we know, sometimes a lexeme is changed in the course of history, not by a regular sound change, but by morphological analogy. Often, not always, often it does that by changing its pattern from one existing class to another one in the language. So this happened to English dig, digged, digged, which for most of us became dig, dug, dug. It also happened, I am told by the Oxford English Dictionary, for slink, slank, slunk. I've never heard slank before, which for me at least is now slink, slunk, slunk. So what we've got is these words that are changing from one existing pattern to another. Now, of course, there is a long, erudite, very interesting debate over the nature of analogy and analogical change, and I don't have time here to do anything like justice to it, but let me name some of the topics which are currently being debated by linguists. We are still working this out. So these include the role that are played by lexical frequencies, the role of hierarchical relationships among lexical classes, the important role of zones of identity versus difference within paradigms. These are things that are being debated by us at the moment. These are factors that we really care about, we're trying to understand them. I'm going to say that these are points of interest which would continue to be important and continue to be studied even within a very abstract picture of analogical change. So here are our paradigms and lexical classes. Suppose I abstracted away from this by removing all of the phonological detail. So now this is English, that's all you're going to get. Now obviously this is a very severe procedure of abstraction. It loses an incredible amount of detail, but a representation like this would still allow us to recognize English versus German versus French. Moreover, factors that linguists really care about, like lexical frequency of the different classes, relationships among the different classes, do still have a presence in the model. Things like zones of similarity and difference are still represented in there in a very real way. And it may be that abstractions like this, as ludicrous and sort of preschoolish as they look, may be the kind of things we need in order to work with mathematicians at the beginning. Certainly, it'll be easier to compute the similarity between two tables filled only with colours than it is to compute the similarity between entire lexicons of inflected words. So this kind of abstraction, I think, is moving us towards what the mathematicians tell us they will need if we're going to get this this line of research started. But nicely, it is not, despite the fact all of the phonology is gone, and the phonologist in me is crying, but the morphologist in me is like, well, I can live with this. It's got a lot of the things that we really care about there. Now, let me push this idea a little bit further. It may be possible to incorporate some notion of sound change even into that really highly abstracted view of paradigm change. So sound change occurs in restricted phonological environments. Consequently, because paradigms contain many varied phonological environments within them, the effects of sound change is typically only felt in some paradigm cells and others. One of the effects that we can get is that what was originally a single coherent lexical class can, due to sound change, be split in two. So, for example, if you're a fan of the history of strong verbs in Germanic, you know that this just kept happening. We started with a few classes and they just kept getting split by sound changes. So this is a process that we could simulate within this really highly abstract kind of representation. This is a simulation of the effects of sound change without simulating the sound changes themselves. We could still notice that two languages seem to have flipped these parts of the paradigms while another one had not, and that can start doing subgrouping. We can still do all of the wonderful things, not all of, we can do some of the important wonderful things that are there. Now, Of course, you may say, all right, good, good, go and simulate that, and at the end of it, you're going to give me a box of little preschool colours and say, there you go, there's your reconstruction. What use is that? Well, remember that the simulations only do part of the work. So they're then given to expert humans. So if my simulation, say, for Australian languages, for a language family that I have not had any time to look at very carefully, if my simulation told me that these two paradigm cells seem to have undergone a change that caused them to diverge from their neighbours, then I, as the expert human linguist, I would be quite happy to then go back to the data and check what it is that seems to have changed here in terms of sound changes. Having a computer simulation to direct my attention would actually be quite helpful and welcome if it did a good job. And since the simulation is being used to search for linguistic forms that change and get inherited in later stages of the language, it's still entirely plausible that even such an impoverished view could help us solve and infer sensible language trees, because we're getting inheritance, we're getting things that change, things that don't, which is what we use to build trees. So that was a brief discussion about really abstract, horrible things to do to your morphology. But the key points were these. To work with mathematicians, it seems to me, we'll need to develop some linguistically sensible abstractions of the systems whose history we'd like to infer. And here I've suggested to you that this kind of severe abstraction might actually be a plausible, not stupid thing to do. It will still allow us to address issues that we care very much about. Now, I briefly illustrated the abstract notion of change in paradigms that attempts to capture known effects, both of an analogy and sound change. I only gave you a couple of slides, didn't defend it particularly well, but I've attempted to talk about that. And that's really not bad, because analogy and sound change, they're really important things. That's a comparative method really cares about that. So they're two central phenomena, and they don't disappear when we turn things into colour. So, again, I'm not going to conclude with all of the answers. This is a discussion. So to summarise and conclude what I have said, particularly for those of us who work outside Europe, but not only us, we really do want to accelerate the comparative method. It is fantastic, it's wonderful, it leads to great insights. And the very good news is that this wish, contrary to 10 years ago, does appear to be realistic if you go and ask a mathematician who would be the person implementing the stuff. Linguists will need assistance if we're going to do this. I think the path to success really will be interdisciplinary. It will involve mathematicians, it will involve linguists. It will not involve either of them working apart from one another and not talking to the other. In order for us to work together, it will require linguists to answer new kinds of questions that have not been burning issues for us previously, but now that we're working in an interdisciplinary way, we need them, they'll be crucial if we want this interdisciplinary help. What we might gain are some methods which do some of the inferential work of the comparative method more quickly. Now, given the number of language families in the world where work has barely begun, that's a useful thing. Of course, we should expect incremental progress, not miracles. There will be back and forth between us and the mathematician. There'll be disappointments, there'll be successes. It's not like someone's going to walk in and say, hey, linguists, I solved your discipline for you. It's not going to be like that. But importantly, we stand to gain from this an accelerated progress towards an understanding of languages over the whole world, not just ones that have been worked on for at least a century, and therefore a significantly increased contribution from linguistics to this interdisciplinary goal of better understanding the human past. And that's what I hope is on the horizon. Thank you.